Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. And the Christ-like mind, if you remember, we've been looking at it, that it's a mind of selflessness. Do you remember that? You know, what we see here is that he emptied himself. He made himself no reputation. And what's that big, big word that comes from the Greek that the theological people talk about? What is it, Brother John?
Kenosis.
The kenosis, the emptying of himself, okay? Yeah, not yet. We can speak Greek. We can say poda.
That's right.
We can say eggs over easy. You know, there's a lot of things that people in Greek diners say. Yeah. Okay. And so a mind of selflessness. And then we also looked at the fact that it's a mind of service. You know, he made himself a servant. And the Christ-like mind. And then, of course, now we're taking a look at the idea of a mind of submission. You know, it says here that he was made in likeness of man, being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death. You know, even the death of the cross. So a mind of submission, he submitted to the Father's will. What did he say in the garden, Raph? Do you remember?
Not my will, but thine.
But thine be done. Yep, that's how to do it. That's the easy, easy way to do it. So that's a mind of submission as we took a look at here. So from early age, man seems to think that he doesn't need to submit, that he's his own boss. Mm-hmm. You know, do you have to teach children how to be their own boss? Huh, Raph? Yeah, you don't? No, you don't have to teach children how to be their own boss.
Bye-bye.
Mine, yes. You know, and you want to go this way, they want to go another way. It's always amazing. You know, we used to have those two little dogs, and always fun to see how they wanted to both go which way. And one time we were in a parking lot over at the Catskill Game Farm. And we took a big open parking lot. There was hardly anybody there. I think we went late in the fall, so there was maybe another car, maybe two other cars, if that. And so what I did is I took the leashes and I put them together and I hooked the two dogs up and I just let them run. Go, dogs, run wherever you want to run. It was so funny to watch because the two dogs want to go two different directions. And they'd be running along and then they'd do like this and the leashes would catch. And
worst part was when they came across the tree and they both decided to go around the opposite
Yeah,
side.
They both went around the tree, one on one side, one on the other. That was a lot of fun. But submissive, you know, so we think we need to be that way, you know. But that's not the mind of Christ. Amen? Mm. Yeah, that's not the mind of Christ. The mind of Christ is to submit.
Amen.
So take a look here at a couple passages of Scripture, if you would. The first one in Matthew 26 and verse number 42, if you would. Matthew chapter 26, verse number 42. And of course, this is what Raph quoted for us earlier. He went away again the second time and prayed, saying, O my Father, if this cup may not pass away from me, except I drink it, thy will be done. Okay, he submitted to it, you know, humbled himself and became obedient unto death. He submitted. And then turn with me to John chapter 4 and verse 34. John chapter 4, verse 34. And here we read, Jesus saith unto them, My meat is to do the will of him that sent me, and to finish his work. to do the will of him that sent me. So that's, you know, submission. And, you know, to do somebody else's will, that's kind of hard. Submission's a hard thing for us. You know, that really is a hard thing for us. And yet that's something that we need to do. It's very, very important for us that we would do that. But, you know, not easy kind of a thing. Trying to remember, where is that verse? Lord, help me to find that, remember that verse. Oh, it's in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 21. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 21. Thank you, Lord. And it says there, submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. So we need to be willing to submit. You know? And of course, that idea of submitting many, many times comes up in relationships, that we need to just set aside our rights because the other person's emotionally involved. Mm-hmm. You know, that sometimes we have to do. You know, let's just suppose, you know, let's just pretend that it's my birthday, okay? So I've got birthday and the candles are going and all that kind of thing. And Jeannie gets a text message on her phone that, I mean, this is horrible to think, but let's just pretend that her sister died. You know, that'd be a terrible thing, you know? Well, obviously, she's not going to be in the let's blow out the candles and have a nice birthday party mood, right? No. But I am, you know, or at least I was until I read that because I love her sisters and that would upset me too. But I would submit to, well, she's in, you know, bad shape. And we're not going to do party right now, right? Because, well, I mean, she's grieving. I mean, she's upset. She's really upset. Amen. Now, let me give you an example. When I was in Bible college, one of the pastors in North Carolina took me under his wing. They have what they call down, God bless you, Jeannie, what they have down south, they have what's called a preacher boy. And so I was the preacher boy. I was his mentor, if you will, or he was my mentor. I was the mentee. Is that what they call it? And you know, we met in his office. Well, you know, once a week. So there I am in his office, and all of a sudden the door bursts open. Here's this man, you know, like this, and behind him is the secretary going, I tried to stop, all this kind of thing, like that, right? Pastor Court says to him, oh, I'm so sorry you're mad. You know, let me just take a minute with you, and I'm really sorry that you're so upset. And he said to me, you know, Brother Bill, would you mind waiting outside and, you know, and all that kind of thing? I mean, Pastor Courts could have said, hey, wait a minute. You know, this is my office. The door was closed. Didn't the secretary tell you not to come out in? You know, hey, wait a minute here. You know? But the man obviously was emotionally controlled. Amen? He was emotionally involved. And sometimes you have to set aside your rights for that. And sometimes that's what submission's really about. You know, and so we need to submit to somebody else's will, and sometimes it's because somebody else is in that kind of a situation. Does that make sense? Any questions about that? So I ask the question: are you willing to do whatever God asks you to do? I like all those answers. I liked how the whole group of you yelled right out, yes, I am! I'm ready! Yeah. Yeah. Is he the Lord Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So if he's the Lord, can he ask you to do things?
Yes.
Yes.
Does he expect you to do them?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Well, okay, Dave.
Amen. Sometimes he asks us to do things to see whether we will.
and then he doesn't.
Right, he doesn't, like, go through with. Now, Abraham, take your son, go up and sacrifice him. You know, did he have to go all the way? Yeah, he almost, I mean, in his heart he did. Don't you think, Devin? Yeah. In his heart he did.
Well, didn't he have the blade raised up?
He had the blade ready. I mean, he's ready to plunge. Yeah,
ready to, come down.
Ready to do it. Yeah, ready to kill his son. So, yep, a lot of times that. So, I mean, you folks don't have any idea how many times I said to God, "Yes, Lord, I will be a missionary wherever you want me to go." And he kept saying to me, "No, you got to stay back here, support missionaries." But I mean, I would have gone anywhere. Well, not Alaska, but you know, Finland. You know, but I mean, I was willing to go. I mean, especially when I had, you know, classmates that were going to, you know, all the Polynesian islands, all the little Micronesia islands, you know, and he had to raise money to get a boat to be able to go from island to island, and the boat had to be big enough to live on, you know. I thought, I mean, that's a tough missionary life, don't you think? Yeah, you know, that'd be a tough missionary life, you know. But, you know, God, every time I said, "Lord, I'm willing to do whatever you want. I'll go wherever you want me to go." And so, you know, are you willing? Yeah, that's the Christ-like mind. You know, Jesus was willing to go do whatever the Father said. Yeah. So then I ask a second question. What would you be unwilling to do? And folks, honestly, if God had called me to Alaska, I'd have gone because he'd have given me the grace to do it. Mm-hmm. And I've heard it said, and I don't know how true it is, but they've said, if you have grown up in Syracuse, New York, you can live anywhere in the world. So I suppose I could have. Yeah. Amen. I say that kind of jesting, but God had given me the grace. Wouldn't he have? You know. But, you know, is there anything you're not willing to do? If there is something that you're not willing to do, then you don't have the mind of Christ. We sold a building that had been built during World War II. And quite interesting, there were no steel nails or screws in the building because steel was all being used during the war, so they had brass. Quite interesting. Where we lived, they used to build a lot of the pleasure craft. The gar boats were built there and Chris Craft were built there. And so the Chris Craft factory had abundance of brass screws that they sold to the church for mere pennies. And they put the church together with brass screws. Yeah, really quite interesting. They're soft, so you know you can't overturn them. They'll strip out. So we sold that building, and we weren't quite ready to build the other building. We were close to it. And, you know, had to get some things worked out with that. So we rented a place. It had been a grocery store, and then it became a VFW hall. And so the VFW hall was, let's drink all we can, rent it out to parties to drink all you can, smoke all you can. We didn't have any idea what the color of the floor was because it had a layer that was sticky of ashes and beer about yay thick. And of course, then we took a look at the bathrooms, and we had to clean them. They were just covered. I didn't really believe it that they were that filthy, that people would still use bathrooms that were that filthy. Well, one day I decided that you know, that somebody needs to clean those toilets before we use them. So I was going to go in and clean them. Oh, wait a minute, you're the pastor. Yeah, I'm the pastor. That's right, but. You know, there's not anything I'm unwilling to do. Did I say that right? Mm-hmm. Right? So
So I got, you know, the bucket and the gloves and all the stuff and go in there. And I opened the door into the bathroom and I got blinded. Wow. Somebody else in the church had gone in and done it already. They'd done it the night before and I didn't even realize it. Mm-hmm. You know, Larry and Barb, the two of them went in there. And he told me later he used a putty knife and scraped everything first. It was that thick. Just incredible. So, anything you're unwilling to do?
I think of Jeremiah and some of the things the Lord asked him to do.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
As a prophet.
Yeah. And Ezekiel.
In the times.
Too,
Well, so many of the prophets.
Yeah.
There were some difficult missions he gave.
That's exactly right. Yeah.
Wouldn't make sense either.
Wouldn't make sense. Yeah, Dave?
Well, when I worked in the prison, I tried witnessing as much as I could. The oppression was really bad.
Yes.
The spiritual oppression.
Yes.
In fact, I felt like I was going to be squished.
Mm-hmm.
And then one day I said, I can't take this anymore.
Right.
And for about 2 or 3 days, I didn't. And it was like a huge weight had lifted off me.
Yes.
And I said, well, I can't go on like this. So I started in again.
Uh-huh.
Even though having that off me was very desirable.
That was tough work. And I only went in, you know, once a week. That was tough work. And you went in all the time. So we have that. Here is a little account here. Soon after we were married, my wife Diane and I joined a Baptist church that was growing and exciting. Isn't that what our church is?
Amen.
Yes, we're growing and exciting. Praise God. While we were on the road in evangelism most weeks during the year, we always enjoyed coming home to our church and being as much a part as we could. The pastor and his family became dear friends, as did many of the couples in that church. But trouble came. Well, Satan doesn't like it. He'll do everything he can to ruin a church. But trouble came soon. We were losing people, and all kinds of rumors began to circulate, none of which turned out to be true. You know? I told you folks how they passed the note down. What he just said was heresy. Yeah, not true, but that's what they said. As an evangelist, I could choose to live wherever I wanted. I wanted to be a part of a strong church, and I was tempted to leave that struggling situation. Can you picture yourself there in any of that? You know, who wants to be around the trouble and that kind of thing? On a particular Wednesday night during the song service, we were singing the song, I'll Go Where You Want Me to Go, Dear Lord. After the first verse, our pastor, who had founded that church and had faithfully served for nearly 25 years, interrupted the song or song leader? Song leader, and said, when we get to the chorus on this next verse, let's sing, I'll Stay Where You Want Me to Stay, Dear Lord. The Holy Spirit stuck the dagger into my heart once again that night. It would have been easy to go anywhere. But there at that moment, the Holy Spirit wanted me to submit and to stay.
Wow.
Amen. Sometimes it's hard to submit, you know, to the will of God. And the author says you don't forget that kind of a lesson. Amen.
That's right.
You don't forget it. Okay. So the mind of Christ is to submit. Amen. And that submission is also comes about by the Spirit. Okay. Christians are often called people who are under mind control. Mm-hmm. You know, there are some people that think that I'm running a cult. You realize that?
Oh, yeah.
Especially because we're King James. We've got to be a cult. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Yeah, we're so much like 12 tribes.
Right.
Because we all live in a commune and everything is communal property.
Right. Yeah.
And we don't eat protein.
Right. And I'm always serving Kool-Aid.
Mm.
drink the Kool-Aid.
Yeah. Of course, you know, I make all the ladies wear long skirts. You know why that is, Bernadette? Because as a cult leader, I've told all the ladies they can't shave their legs. So then they want to cover that, so they all wear long. Anna, somebody said that. Really, Emmanuel? They said that about us here at our church.
You never said that.
What's that?
I've never said that.
No. Shave your legs, please, ladies. You know.
So I can stop shaving my legs.
Yeah. No, don't shave them, Dave.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. But you know, under mind control, you know, ooh, I've got you all. You know, are you feeling sleepy? I am. Okay. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 6. I plead guilty. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse number 6.
16.
16, rather. 16. Sorry about that. For who hath known the mind of the Lord that we may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ.
Amen.
You know, that's, yeah. It is mind control. I'm submitting my mind to the mind of Christ. Let him control me. Mm. Amen? Mm-hmm. And that's what we need to do. You know, that's important for us to do. Isn't it better to have the mind of Christ than to have the mind of the world or your own mind in certain things? Yeah. The mind of the flesh. Mind of the world a lot of times gets us in trouble.
Yeah, and the world thinks we're blindly submitting to this and we don't think for ourselves.
Right.
In reality, it's taken a lot of thought.
Yeah.
It's the point to, you know, turn your life over to Jesus Christ. That's a big deal.
Big deal.
It's not a...
Yeah. And they talk about a blind leap of faith. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not a blind leap of faith. I know who I believe in.
Yeah.
You know, I'm persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed against that day, you know.
Amen.
So,
At the same time, they're blindly following whatever.
Yeah, evolution. Yeah.
Broadway.
Humanism. Yeah, that Broadway. Exactly, oh, right?
I want to say a testimony. I've probably said it before, but about a month before accepting Jesus Christ, this one heavy metal show I was at, and then I said something, they were just kind of improvising, making fun of me, and I yelled, "Hey, Jesus loves you," and their equipment broke down.
Yeah.
It was a sign for me, but no one else got it.
No one else did, yeah.
It's just how God works that way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Except maybe the guy who was kind of in front of me was laughing about it.
Uh-huh.
He saw what happened.
Isn't that something? Yeah. Bless you, Mary. Yeah.
Singer said, "Well, that's technology for you."
Yeah.
The show's over.
Yeah. Yeah. A couple other passages to take a look at, if you would. Romans chapter 8, verse 5 and 6. Romans chapter 8, verse 5 and 6. It says, "For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace." I know which side of that whole equation I want to be on. Amen?
Amen.
Yep, I surely do. And then we go back over here to 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 1 and 2, if you would. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 1 and 2. The Word of God says to us, "For as much then as Christ hath suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind. For he that hath suffered in the flesh hath ceased from sin, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh to the lusts of men, but to the will of God. You know, very, very important, very good verse for us there, that we need to do that kind of thing. That's so important. So the conclusion here. How will you choose your life ahead? You make the choice every day. You make the choice whether you want to stay in the flesh or stay in the spirit, have the mind of Christ. Yes. You have that choice. Amen. I can't force it on you. You know, and I have no control over you. Here's another little account here. Years ago, I was privileged to speak at a summer camp for teenagers with Dr. Ed Nelson, longtime pastor and educator. In one of his messages, he told how one day he and his wife were walking down the street to a restaurant in Denver, Colorado, when they stopped. When they spotted the headline of the newspaper in a vending machine. Right? The headline read, "Lucy Dies." Dr. Nelson looked at his wife and said, "Who's Lucy?" She didn't know either, and so upon sitting down to eat, they asked the waitress who Lucy was. She said, "Lucille Ball from I Love Lucy." Dr. Nelson and his wife looked at each other and shrugged. Neither of them had ever heard of Lucille Ball or the famous television program. And by the way, she's from over there at Jamestown, New York. That's where she lived. And so there's, every year they have a thing there, you know, and all kinds of ladies come. They think they look like her. They dress up like her, dye their hair red like her, and all this stuff. It's kind of a funny thing there. But I thought to myself, that's impossible. Everybody of that era had heard of I Love Lucy. Now maybe, you know, Emmanuel never heard of the show, but it was a comedy show. It was this Lucy would do all kinds of stupid, dumb things. I mean, just dumb. She'd get herself into more trouble, and then her husband would have to try to help her out, and see all these schemes that she'd try to work out for his birthday party, or I mean, just all kind of just dumb stuff. Over and over again. And there's another couple that lived in the apartment building that she would always get recruit them to help out, and it just was a mess. It really was. The Nelsons had never heard of them. He went on to explain that he and his wife had never watched a single moment of television in their entire lives up to that point. I was stunned. Not even the news, the World Series, Super Bowl, nothing. Never watched any. As I contemplated that later, I thought, what have they missed? The answer, not much. Their minds and hearts were not cluttered with non-essential things, not to mention the countless temptations to sin that they were never exposed to either. Their lifetime of ministry was testimony to their minds being filled with the things that are true, honest, just, pure, lovely, of good report, virtuous, and praiseworthy. We have the same choice. That's what you've got under your conclusion there. You can put it down. You can choose to live in the flesh or live, you know, in the spirit, have the mind of Christ. So I ask you to choose to have the mind of Christ. Amen? Amen. Choose to have that, if you would. Do you remember that? Let's see if you're right. Oh, you are. Yeah, what would Jesus think? Yeah. A mind of selflessness, a mind of service, and a mind of submission. That's a Christ-like mind we ought to have. Amen. So, it's quiz time. Here you go. First question. See, Bernadette, you haven't graduated yet, so you have to take this quiz. Here you go. Quiz time. She goes, oh, no, not another. Not another. Hope you get a break from that for a while, right? Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But now you'll start memorizing lines. You can do that. Okay, that's good. Here we go. Romans chapter 1, verse 25. Romans chapter 1, verse 25. The Word of God says, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. So how does this verse describe your Christianity? Okay, I suppose I need to help you a little bit with it. If you serve the creature, that's serving self. Does that make sense to you? To have the mind of Christ, you have to put off self. You have to put to death the old man and those kinds of things that the scripture tells us to do, you know. And how many lies do you believe that the world pumps at you? So does that help any of you to have an answer? Explain your answer. Here, I'll help you out. Answers may vary, whatever you come up with. Amen? Of course, everybody's sitting there going, Pastor, if I say anything, then everyone will know that I'm not the Christian I ought to be. Okay, I'll go on to question two. The greatest goal we could have for our lives is to be a servant. We are to have Christ's mind, and His mind is to serve. How can we serve people this week? In what ways can you serve more this week than you did last week? And you know, when I asked this before, I got a little bit of flack on this. Well, Pastor, wait a minute. You know, the Bible talks about don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. And, we don't want to be bragging about this kind of thing. You know, if I say, well, I'm serving this way, I'm serving that way, then, you know, there goes all, I got the glory of men, there goes all my reward for it. No, the reason for asking that and the reason for telling that is to help others to see how they can serve also. Oh, if so-and-so can do that, I can do that too. But some of you are kind of upset at me pushing this earlier in the lesson. What's that?
Just like the one guy, Paul I know, Jesus I know, but who are you?
Right, yes. Yeah. But serving, yeah.
Aren't you to make your ministry known?
Well, I think there's a verse in there that does say that. I'm not sure right off where that is, but you know, it's to encourage and exhort one another to love and to good works. You know, that's why we gather here. But you know, if we're in here, we're not trying to brag to get the glory of men. We're just trying to. So how can you serve God's people this week? By serving them, somebody at least say that much. Yes, Mary.
Well, sometimes sending writing a letter to somebody, sending them a note.
Mm-hmm. Just a little encouragement note kind of thing. Yeah, it's always a blessing to get those.
Or smiling and saying hi. People are so just not into greeting people.
Right.
They don't know.
Yeah,
I was in the elevator. No, there was a girl in the elevator. I was in the elevator and a girl walked in. I was like, oh, hi. And she looked at me really strange. She was like, you spoke. And I was just like, what?
Yeah.
She was like, people don't speak usually, especially in the elevator. People don't say hi. I'm glad you said hi. Hi. And I was okay, hi.
Yeah, it's true.
Right.
Yeah, so, it's true. Yeah.
Just smiling, saying hi, acknowledging people.
Yes. And a smile is translated into every language exactly the same. Yeah.
Johan can greet everybody he sees.
Sure.
So
Yeah. 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 Hi. Right. got to do those kinds of things.
Smile makes you smile. It is contagious.
Yeah, he's got a good smile.
Get out a smiley track. The other day, and the girl didn't crack a smile. Oh, she was.
Can I give you a smile? And she didn't want that. No.
Well, she took it, but it was no smile.
No smile. Yeah. All right. We asked this question just a few minutes ago, in the lesson. What about your willingness to do what God wants you to do? Hey, Brother Dave, what if God said to you right now, I want you to be a missionary to, the island of Puerto Rico?
I have been invited to other countries.
Yeah, for execution. Is that what
you
mean?
No. I said, well, if the Lord kept me alive.
Yeah.
That's the big thing.
Yeah, what if God said be a missionary to India?
If he can get me there.
Yeah. Oh, he would if he called you.
How will I last? That's up to him.
Yeah. Yeah. You know what's interesting? There are people that have gone to be missionaries way older than Dave.
Wow.
Start at 80 years old to go be a missionary. I mean, we had a couple in our church that was, oh, boy, what do you think Mike was? Was he about... 45 or so, had six kids. God called him to be a missionary. He said, yep, I'm going. Yeah.
I think,
and they all said, oh, you get six kids, you can't take six kids on mission field. How are you going to take care of six kids? And I think of the Rodriguez's with 11 now, wanting 12.
It was convicting because I think some villages were called, but they never went.
They didn't go. That was exactly right.
Oh, yeah. I thought Aruba went on 80.
You want to go to Aruba when you're 80, okay? Yeah. Brother John?
I think the key thing is they're what God asks you to do.
Yes.
You know, that you'll have mankind, men sharing what they think you should do.
Right.
And the focus should be on what God asks you to do.
Exactly.
His will. And
exactly.
Not somebody else's will, not your will, but
God's will.
His will.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So I'd be unwilling to do, you know, things that men are asking me to do.
Wow.
Right.
To do what God asks.
What God asks you to do. Yeah. For sure, we need to be willing to do that. What God asks us to do. And by the way, a need is not a call.
Wow.
I mean, there is a lot of need for missionaries, you know, all over the world. I mean, there's a lot of need. And just like Brother John and I were talking to one of the speakers who's looking for a church that we just saw last Monday, you know, there's a lot of churches even here in New York that have a need of a pastor. Mm. But the need is not the call.
Right.
And just because there's the need. God will call you, and that's what's important for you. Okay. P.T. Forsyth said, the purpose in life is not to find your freedom, but your master. Boy, that's quite a statement. Give five reasons that show how you are living a life that is directed to becoming more like your master. Here's an example. I memorize scripture to have the mind of Christ. You know, thy word have I hidden mine heart that I might not sin against thee. Isn't that in Psalm 119 and verse... Is it 11? I think it is. Somewhere in there. But, you know, so we need to memorize Scripture. Right?
Pray without ceasing.
What's that? Pray without ceasing. Good. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. 2 Timothy 2:15. Am I right?
16.
Quench not the Spirit in Ephesians chapter 4.
Obey God rather than man.
Obey God rather than man. Good.
Trust the Lord with all thine heart.
And lean not to thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths.
Proverbs 3:5-7, 5-6,
somewhere in there.
Hope of me on the Lord Jesus Christ.
You got to say it loud enough for Jeannie to hear it.
We'll put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof.
Amen. Romans 13, verse 14. Good.
By loving the brethren.
Loving the brethren. Yeah, by this shall all men know that ye are my disciples if ye have love one for another. John chapter 13, verse 35. Somewhere there.
Brotherly love continue, and that's almost the same thing.
Brother, let brotherly love continue. Yeah.
Then we have to remember that in us,
yes,
dwelleth no good thing.
That's right. That in my flesh.
In my flesh.
In me is in my flesh dwelleth no good thing. That's right. Romans 7. Very good. When we get our thoughts out of the way, we can develop the mind of Christ. So let's read out loud together here. Ephesians chapter number 4, verse 20 and 21. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 20 and 21. And the Word of God says this. Ready? But ye have not so learned Christ, if so be that ye have heard him and have been taught by him as the truth is in Jesus. Very good. Okay. Number 6 here. According to Romans 15:3, not one single day of Jesus' existence was for himself. You know? So that's what Romans 16:3 said. Said, for even Christ pleased not himself. You know, but as it is written, the reproaches of them that approached thee fell on me. So the question goes on, what did he live for according to John 8:29? It's an open book test. Who's got it? Somebody wants to read it out, or what do you want? Going to read it?
Yeah, John chapter 8, verse 29 says, and he that sent me is with me. The Father hath not left me alone, for I do always those things that please him.
Amen. Amen. Good. All right. So Jesus lived for the task of always, and I'm glad you emphasized that, Emmanuel, doing those things that pleased his Father. Mm-hmm. Right. Okay, 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 2. Remember, it said in verse 1 that perilous times shall come. You know, perilous times like atom bombs and, you know, Godzilla, all those kinds of things. Perilous times shall come. But then verse 2, you know, starts out with, for men shall be lovers of their own selves.
Selfishness.
Me first. Who cares about others? You know? Yeah. Men and women, boys and girls, selfish at heart. Selfish. How do you choose to live the rest of your life? Amen? Yeah. The lust of the flesh or the lust of or the mind of Christ? Remember we read those verses just a few minutes ago?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. At 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 1 and 2, very good. Those are very good verses with this lesson in mind. And they're not read very often. For as much then as Christ hath suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind. For he that hath suffered in the flesh hath ceased from sin, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh to the lust of men, but to the will of God. Yeah, it's very, very good. Nothing is happening here. Come on, computer. Okay, it's going to be that way, huh? No wonder nothing is happening. That's the end. So where I had this one, this, I should have repeated this at the end. Yep, thank you, class. You're a great class. I appreciate it. All right, any questions about the mind of Christ? Yep, the mind of Christ, you know. What's on your mind? That's what we've been looking at several lessons. Have one more lesson on it. What's on your mind? Our mind is an incredible thing. It's really incredible. All right, let's bow together. Father, thank you again for being able to look at these things about our mind. And Lord, we need to have this the same mind that Christ have. Otherwise, that flesh and the world just get to us. And we want to make sure that we no longer live the rest of our time in the flesh to the lusts of men, but that we might have the will of God and be willing to do that, to be the servant we need to be selfless in our thoughts, and to be always looking for ways to serve and always being ready to submit to thy will. And so just help us. Well, thank you. May the morning service be to your glory. Lord, help any that might be coming. Be with Blaine and Kitty as they're down in Alabama with their family, and just help them to be a witness to them this day. And Blaine's mom especially, we don't know physically what all she's going through, whether she's healing or whether she's dying. We just pray that you'd help that this woman had come to know Christ before it's eternally too late. And so we're looking to you. Bless us. We need you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen, my dear ones. Lord bless.